Welcome to the ARU Startup Podcast. My name is Omkar Singh, and today we are joined by our special guest, Professor Gary Packham. Professor Packham is a Pro Vice Chancellor for Student Enterprise and Entrepreneurship at ARU and Professor for Entrepreneurship. He is the visionary mind behind the setup of entrepreneurship at the Anglia Ruskin. So let's welcome Professor Packham. Hello.
Hello, Omkar. Lovely to be here.
We have been knowing you as a Pro Vice Chancellor and a professor. I would like to know, and our audience would like to know more about your academic journey, your personal side of things. So what's your journey being as a, how you became as a Pro Vice Chancellor?
It's quite a long story, Omkar, but to maybe try and pray say it a little bit for you. After my A-levels, I didn't go straight to university. I went to work in financial services, supporting small business lending, personal lending. And that was at the time of the late 80s, early 90s. And it was a very interesting period in which we kind of flipped from lending to as many businesses and people as we could to the crash and not being able to support a lot of people who were going through quite a difficult period at that time. I think that made me reflect on what I wanted to do. And I think because I had friends that had gone to university, I thought that maybe I wanted a different career, and maybe I needed to start again. So I decided to take the step back into academia and start my degree as a mature student, albeit I was only in my early 20s when I did that. And I studied business and specialised within that business degree in small business and entrepreneurship. After my degree, in which I did very well, I was offered a scholarship to undertake a PhD in small business growth, which was great from my institution. And after I started my PhD, there was an opportunity to become a research fellow supporting a really interesting project around fast growth in Wales. And that was identifying, working with, finding out more about why certain firms in Wales were growing exponentially, really quickly. And it also very much aligned to my PhD. Through that, I was able to not only get experience in research, but also complete my PhD, at which point I was offered a lectureship in small business entrepreneurship, progressed through to becoming a deputy head of a enterprise department, and then a senior position in a faculty looking after academic programs. But at all times, I was very much involved in supporting enterprise entrepreneurship. And I was also a director of a Centre for Entrepreneurship. Then the opportunity came to join ARU. And I joined ARU back in 2012 as a Deputy Dean for Research and Innovation. And I was very much here to deliver world-leading research through the Research Excellence Framework. But very quickly, there was an opportunity to lead the faculty, and I was able to lead the Faculty of Business and Law, as it is now. And that job came with a Pro Vice Chancellor role as well, in which I supported things such as internationalisation, innovation, employability. And more recently, in the last 12 months, I was given the opportunity to take forward this new exciting agenda that we're trying to progress and move forward at ARU in terms of supporting our students and our graduates to think about enterprise entrepreneurship, whether that be as part of a job as an employee or in terms of pursuing an entrepreneurial career and maybe becoming a freelancer, self-employed, or even starting a business. So whether you want to be an employee or an employer, this is really about helping our students and our graduates succeed and realize their potential.
So how do you see entrepreneurship in your journey? One thing that you think has been very entrepreneurial in terms of what has brought you today?
Universities are an absolutely brilliant place. They employ brilliant people doing lots of very interesting, very kind of world-leading kind of activities, whether that be teaching or research, or other kinds of innovation. And it's a really kind of a can-do and exploring what's possible.
Yeah.
And I think in an academic environment, the ability to not only ask why, but why not?
Yeah.
It's really important in terms of challenging the status quo, making a difference and making things happen.
Yeah.
And it's not just about you know, publications, not just about teaching, but it's also about having a real impact upon people, communities, business and society.
Yeah.
So I would say in terms of being entrepreneurial, universities, and universities in particular, such as ARU, are great places for students, graduates, academics, professional service staff to really think about how to do things differently, challenge the status quo, and make that difference.
Yeah, yeah. And I mean, the reason I ask that, because it is not essentially a misconception, but people think entrepreneurship has to do only with starting a business. How do you see this one?
No, entrepreneurship is also about recognizing opportunities and being able to realize those opportunities. And that's not always about a new business idea. That might be innovation within practice. That might be about making something better or improving a system or process. But it's about recognizing there's an opportunity to do something different, something that has a benefit and has a positive outcome or impact, and being confident and being capable of making that happen.
Yeah, yeah. And why do you think entrepreneurship or enterprise education as a whole is important for students at a university level?
Well, I think increasingly, irrespective of whether you're going to be working for somebody else, or increasingly a lot of students and graduates go on to work for themselves, entrepreneurship and enterprise provides a number of kind of skills that are very transferable and very much demanded by employers, and can also, you know, really help you realize your potential, realize your ambitions and aspirations. So enterprise is about, you know, creativity, about problem solving, it's about resilience, it's about adaptability. It's really about being able to deal with what's in front of you, look at the options and come up with some solutions that will have a positive outcome. And that can be applied to, you know, any situation in life. It doesn't have to be work related, doesn't have to be, you know, your own business related. It could be within the community, it could be in your personal life. It's about having that mindset, that kind of can do, the ability to think differently, and be able to kind of say, yeah, okay, we need to change this. How do we do that? And how do we make that better?
Yeah, I think this is very important to also highlight that entrepreneurship is not just limited to starting a business, but about the mindset, and it is also applicable in various areas of interest or whatever the career students pursue in. In particular, what Anglia Ruskin University is doing for the students or the graduates in this field?
Okay, so in terms of our students, we have the Anglia Ruskin Enterprise Academy. And we run a lot of support there out of the academy in terms of trying to develop enterprise skills, provide opportunities to explore new opportunities, to discover what enterprise and entrepreneurship is all about, think about what that might mean for an individual or a team, the ability to bring people together from different disciplines, different backgrounds, and to kind of talk about and explore things that are maybe not quite right within the community, within business, and coming up with new ideas about how they can be tackled and how they can be addressed for the benefit of all. And what's important about the academy is it's not just about you and when you're here as a student, it's about what you do next on graduation. And we recognise that for many of our students, many of our graduates, it might not be the first thing that they do, but we need to be somewhere that they can come back to and seek that support, whether they are students or graduates. So we are here with you to support you on that journey. It's a journey of discovery, it's a journey of developing your skills, and hopefully it's about a journey about realizing your potential.
So speaking from your perspective, essentially, is what is the strategic direction of the university and future plans? What can students expect more coming out of your visionary thoughts?
So I think you can probably put that into three categories. The first one is about discovery and exploration. Some people that come to the university might not know much about what enterprise entrepreneurship is. I think many realize once they've gone through that kind of journey of discovery and explored the concept, that a lot of them are thinking, well, I'm already doing aspects of this already. So it's about normalizing that. For those who are thinking about how does this help with my future career? How does this help maybe with my aspirations to be self-employed, start a business? It's about giving them the space to create and develop those ideas, test those ideas in a relatively safe environment, draw on the total support that's here at the university, because it's not just about the academy. We have a lot of excellent members of staff who are doing research in particular areas, are only too happy to provide advice, guidance and critique ideas and perhaps offer advice about how they can be developed and made better. And finally, it's about that launching and growing kind of element. Those that go on to actually start a business and hopefully go on to grow those business. And we're also providing increasingly for many of our students are thinking about, given the way that work is evolving, that they might not want to be working for somebody else, or they might want to be have a portfolio of careers, or they might be wanting to work some of the time for somebody else. They want to pursue their passion, whether that be in art, whether that be in science, engineering, whether that be in law, opportunity to become self-employed and, you know, seek alternative income sources and opportunities. And there's also those that are really kind of, you know, geared and want to come in, be very successful entrepreneurs who want, not only want to establish a business, but really grow a business and employ people and generate a lot of wealth and innovation within our society and within our economy.
Yeah, and for the student related in STEM courses, any particular offer they have got in terms of entrepreneurship?
So do you mean within the course portfolio? So there's actually a lot going on within the curriculum already in many of the faculties. It's not necessarily labelled as enterprise entrepreneurship, but if you were to take our colleagues in health and education, a lot of them do modules on innovation in practice, in which they're taking something that's happening within a situation, within the sector, and looking at ways that could be improved, enhanced for the benefit of patients or benefit of that trust or whatever it might be already. We have all the work that we do through the academy, which is runs alongside our curriculum. And as part of that, students can, in collaboration with the AIUCPD, gain credits, professional kind of development credits, in enterprise entrepreneurship, which they can then take to an employer or they can take somewhere else to show what they've developed, what they've learned in terms of enterprise entrepreneurship.
Yeah, and there is NHS CEP, which is also available for the medical related students.
So
is this part of
the Clinical Entrepreneurs Program is run in partnership with the AIU and the NHS, and it's very much looking at supporting medical professionals, those in healthcare, to think about how they might develop innovations that have a particular, you know, relevance to health and medicine.
Yeah,
and that's a very successful program that has, you know, made absolutely amazing strides in terms of investment, number of businesses started, but also, I think more importantly, the number of patients that have actually benefited from those innovations.
Yeah, so I mean, there are a lot of opportunities available for students from all the faculties.
Absolutely, and I think coming soon, i.e. for this year, this academic year, 2023-24, we have introduced a new support platform called Underpin, and we partnership with Underpin because many of our students are already self-employed or doing things that are related to their studies, making money as part of it. You know, a lot of students have to work as part of their studies. Yeah. And we've recognised that, and we want to support more students to become more successful, more professional in terms of their freelancing offer, you know, putting their, like, uploading their profile, making them visible to prospective clients, and securing business. Because it's not just about working for somebody else while you're studying. Many of our successful students, many of our successful entrepreneurs, started their businesses or became self-employed while they were studying. And we've got great examples of medical students running jewellery businesses, etc. So it doesn't even have to be related to the course of study. It's about developing those interests, developing those other hobbies, those other skills, and making that work for you. So that's something that we're really excited about. And many of our students and many of our graduates fall into that kind of category.
Yeah.
And we want to make sure that they are supported, not just while they're here with ARU, but beyond ARU as part of our alumni and our graduate community.
Yeah, so yeah, I was about to ask questions related to graduation. So does the offer for the graduates or the alumni members remain same after studies?
The concept is slightly different. So as students, there's the avenues about is exploration, it's about discovery, and it's about that support and building those skills, that awareness. But for our graduate entrepreneurs, many of them will already have made the decision to become self-employed or start a business.
Yeah.
So some of that support has to be more direct and has to be more focused on what they need now. That doesn't mean that we as ARU are just going to do all that ourselves. We are partnering with a number of organisations, whether that be the Institute of Enterprise Entrepreneurs, which we recognise as a centre of excellence, whether that's the Federation of Small Business, whether that's the Institute Directors, whether that be the local chambers of commerce. There's a lot of support already out there for our graduates. But what we're here to do is to make sure that we are effectively signposting our graduates to the right support at the right time so that they can take that forward quickly to become a more successful entrepreneur or business owner.
Yeah, yeah. Now, you mentioned about the Underpin platform. I was speaking to a student recently and he mentioned about his freelance or a side hustle currently going on, and I think this platform is definitely going to help them in boost whatever they are currently up to. You also mentioned about the external collaborations. So any external collaborations at the moment that ARU is having or looking forward to have that will support students?
I think there's a number of collaborations that we're exploring. We have a very good relationship with the Chambers of Commerce, Federation of Small Business. All our students can benefit from discounted membership from the Federation of Small Business as a part of that collaboration. I've mentioned that we're a centre of excellence for the Institute of Enterprise Entrepreneurship, which is a sector body that for enterprise across the UK. And that means that our students can have access to learning materials, accreditation and support. And we have to recognise that many of these organisations that we partner with have got specific support, whether that be financial, whether that be legal, whether that be access to funding, that are all our students, all our graduates can avail themselves to in terms of realizing their aspirations around enterprise and entrepreneurship.
And we talk about intrapreneurship or entrepreneurship. And then there is another work around embedding entrepreneurial education within the curriculum. Do you think it is important for a student to have this as a part of academic study?
Okay, well, if I take entrepreneurship first or being entrepreneurial within a work setting,
yeah,
I think it's really important to kind of make that point that most employers are looking for a range of skills as enterprise entrepreneurial skills. People that can come into the organisation, make things happen, ask the right questions, not just asking why, but why not, challenging that status quo and developing new ways, new ideas, new innovations that help that those businesses thrive and grow and develop. And not just in an economic sense, but also in terms of social value. And in terms of those kind of wider aims that a lot of organisations have around community, environment and social inclusion and those kind of things. So it's not just about the economic prerogative, it's about people coming in and also adding the social side, the environmental side, and making those businesses better, more responsible as well. In terms of enterprise education, entrepreneurship education, it's not a new term. It's been around for a long time. I think that if you look back over in history, it was a very popular policy mechanism back in the late 90s and 2000s. I think many institutions have continued with it, but although maybe some of the support for it has disappeared, maybe some of the kind of governmental support has disappeared over the years. But I would say that there has to be a joined-up approach to enterprise education, but whether it be primary, secondary, or tertiary education, sometimes what we do in education is that we maybe restrain or constrain enterprise,
yeah,
because of conformity. You know, there, I understand that we need to assess and we need to look at people meeting quality standards or particular, you know, benchmarks, but the most creative in society are often younger people, because they're not constrained in the same way. They're not institutionalized in the same way. And rather than maybe being scared of that, maybe suppressing that, how do we actually embrace that so that we can get that intergenerational kind of effect across business, across society? I often say that, you know, some of the most entrepreneurial people I know are young children. And I remember when I was my children being quite enterprise entrepreneurial, and many of their friends being kind of enterprise entrepreneurial when they're 7, 8. Because what young people do is if they don't like something, they change the rules or they change the circumstances.
Yeah.
I think as we grow older, we become less comfortable and become more, you know, aligned with conformity. So how do we kind of continue to embrace and encourage that kind of creative destruction, as Schumpeter would have called it back in the 19th century, 20th century. How do we kind of embrace that, and how do we kind of develop that and channel that in the right way? So I think enterprise education, not just at universities, but at primary and secondary, is really important. And if we really get that right, I think that we would see a much stronger pipeline and a stronger kind of move towards entrepreneurial careers, especially within young people.
No, I think that's a very interesting point you made, that in a 7 year or 8 year old kid is entrepreneurial. I think it is also about I feel like everyone is entrepreneurial. It's just that they're not acknowledging the terminology that it is an entrepreneurship, and it is, as I said, it's about channeling into a right direction.
Yeah, I think sometimes, Umkar, we get hung up on the terminology of enterprise entrepreneurship, and I think it's very easy for people to say that's not me.
Yeah,
I think if you ask a lot of very successful business people whether they're entrepreneurs, they a lot of those people have a problem or have a challenge of being called an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
So I don't think we need to be hung up on the terminology. It's about people, about recognizing opportunities, realizing those opportunities and exploiting those opportunities, not just for economic gain, but for social and environmental gain as well, that we need to really kind of encourage that. And maybe sometimes we put a label on it and that's a self-selecting label, and maybe we need to be a little bit more kind of more open and find words and allow people to kind of label themselves as they want to, but in terms of their mindset, in terms of their skills, in terms of what they do, they are being enterprising, they are being entrepreneurial, but they might not want to be labeled as such or might not recognize the words. That's not a problem. I think the issue is that we need to make sure people are doing that.
And I was reading your article in the magazine, the first issue of the Inside Area magazine, and you mentioned about the contribution of SMEs in the economy in the UK. How do you see now, from an ARU student starting a business, what impacts it creates on at a large scale?
Well, I think it's commonly accepted that within most developed economies, small businesses or small medium enterprises dominate the business community. So around 99% of all businesses in the UK are going to be small or medium. And of that group, you know, a significant proportion, around, you know, 68-70% are just going to be self-employed, i.e. people who are just working for themselves but not employing everybody out.
Yeah.
And the rest, majority are going to be employing less than 5 or 10 people. So it's a significant chunk of our business community. And I think that we often celebrate the fact that we've got this excellent community of small and medium-sized enterprises. And we will talk about their contribution to both wealth creation, to innovation, to employment creation. But sometimes they get left behind because, you know, there's only so much funding, there's only so much support that's available. It's very difficult to pick winners before they win. So there's a real balance about where support is headed. It's often aligned to particular sectors that are government priorities, yet many of our businesses operate outside of those priorities. You know, let's take creative industries, let's take hospitality. They're not necessarily in industries that are, or sectors that are well supported, but they are dominated by SMEs. So I appreciate there's a challenge there because there's only so much support and funding that to go around, and it's about just the level of impact. But that's why I think enterprise education, enterprise entrepreneurial education is so important, because that is the way that we can help develop those people. We can still have our priority sectors, we can still have our priority measures. If enterprise and entrepreneurship education is helping everybody to develop those skills, develop that expertise, they're going to be much more successful and they're going to be much more resilient and adaptable when they go on to start their own business or be self-employed.
Yeah. I think, and also I've been recently reading a few of the articles around the importance of financial education within the curriculum for the students at the school. And this has been included by the government at a central level. But on the other side, for the enterprise education, do you think there is a need of work to be done in terms of having a transparency and a sense of responsibility, or where the profile this sits under, and how this will be a strategic move for the central government?
I think there's evidence to suggest now that perhaps there are countries out there that are moving ahead of the UK and other developed countries in terms of what support and what infrastructure is in place for small businesses, entrepreneurs, etc. I think, you know, the UK has a developed set of national framework conditions, of which education is one of those important framework conditions. But I think that maybe there needs to be a rethink about how we are supporting enterprise entrepreneurship throughout the curriculum, looking at that pipeline, looking at how that develops. Because as young people come through the education system, they need to be able to be encouraged, supported, and enabled at the various points. If they're only finding out about enterprise entrepreneurship when they're at universities, and there's research out there suggests that students that come to university are more likely to be considering an entrepreneurial career, which is really positive. But is there more that we could be doing across the education spectrum to really support and engender that kind of mindset, that kind of, you know, desire to explore and to discover and create new futures for each other? So I think that, you know, I would certainly be, unsurprisingly, as a professor of entrepreneurship, we have done it previously. You know, there has been that emphasis previously, but as with many things, funding moves on, different priorities come along, and to what extent can that be maintained without a focus, without some funding, without that support? I mean, that's up for debate. But for me, looking at enterprise entrepreneurship across the whole spectrum, and maybe developing that as one of our key national framework conditions that really support, and enable enterprise entrepreneurship, be an important element for me, and one that we should maybe reflect on and revisit.
Yeah. I think generally overseeing, there's a lot of work I think centrally need to be worked around in terms of embedding this in the curriculum and having support, enhanced support for SMEs and students starting in businesses, and having that sort of encouragement for students to go test and try for entrepreneurship. And I think university is a space where they can explore opportunities. So it is not just about joining the university for getting an employment, but as you said, it's also about creating an employment. And I think that really makes a huge impact when you create employment, when you generate employment. I think, and it also comes from an ideation. So for a student maybe who joined us, I think that we had a lot of examples from a student who joined university. They did not think of going into a business, but suddenly they come across something within their academic journey that, oh no, this can be an idea, this can be a business idea. They apply for fund grants and they go for it. And we have seen successful ARU students in entrepreneurship and some good businesses. Thank you. This was a very insightful discussion we had today. We discussed about the strategic direction of the university, how ARU is supporting students and graduates. And I think it is sure to say that it is an entrepreneurial university. And going forward, there's a lot for students to get involved with, to get engaged with. We also touched base about the policies, the government and the SMEs sector as well. So thank you so much for Professor Packham for joining us. And it was really great to have you on the podcast. Before leaving us, do you have any message for students and graduates?
For students that are already joining us now or students that have graduated, please stay in touch. We want to be very much a destination of choice for enterprising people. We want to support those aspirations. We want to be able to support and enable you to realise that potential. And ARU is really about transforming lives through innovative, inclusive, entrepreneurial teaching and research. And that's kind of really at the heart of what we do. So what I would say is find out more, get involved, ask questions, challenge us, tell us what you need, and, you know, come on this journey together, because we really want more of our students, more of our graduates to be making an impact, whether that be in business, society or in local communities. We're here to help you and we're here to help you realise that potential. Just come along and we can help you.
Thank you so much. And thank you so much for staying with us. We'll be coming up with more podcast episodes like this. Stay tuned with us. Thank you so much.